Hello guys, this is Adit. Welcome to my channel Movement Science, where I simplify biomechanics with joke. So if you're new to this channel, consider subscribing. Also check me out on Instagram, where I post pictures of my notes and also put out some daily MCQs. The reference time for all the topics that I'm going to cover will be mentioned down in the description, so check that out and let's get started. In this video, we are going to talk about the kinematics of the SI joint. What is kinematics? The movements that are present in the SI joint. And kinetics we will discuss in the next video. I was actually going to club them together, but then kinematics itself, it kept increasing the content. So I thought I'll split them apart. So honestly, when I started off, my knowledge about kinematics wasn't that strong. After preparing this video, I can say I'm really confident with this concept. So it's going to be a very interesting topic. So let's start. So kinematics can be divided into symmetrical and asymmetrical movements at the SI joint. Okay. The movement at the SI joint is very less, so it's hardly noticeable, but we are still going to look at it and we'll see how the movements exactly occur. So under symmetrical, you can divide it into nutation and counter-nutation, and under asymmetrical, there is torsion. So we'll look at asymmetrical movements later. First, we'll go on to the symmetrical movements. So that is first nutation. Now what is happening is basically in nutation, this space that you can see, so this is your sacrum, right? And this bone is the bone of your pelvis. So that is your innominate bone. Now why do I call it innominate bone? The pelvis is formed by these two bones and this sacrum. Now these two bones, they don't have a name as such. Together it's called as pelvis, but if you take out sacrum from it, these two bones, they don't have a name, so that's why they are called as the innominate bones. Okay, see, innominate. Okay, so I'll be using this term throughout the video, so get familiar with that. So coming back to nutation, in nutation what happens is this space that you can see between the innominate bone and the sacrum, it increases, whereas in counter nutation this space that you can see reduces. Okay, so how does this occur? Now the movement can be described in three ways. First, you can describe the movement of the sacrum. Second, you can describe the movement of the innominate bone. And third is the movement of both the bones, right? So starting with the sacrum movement, the sacral promontory moves anteriorly and coccyx moves posteriorly. So if you can see, this is your sacral promontory, the purple part that I have marked, and the coccyx is in the posterior region. So the sacral promontory moves anteriorly, so it goes anteriorly, whereas the coccyx will go posteriorly, right? So this makes up your nutation. Now another way you can describe the same movement is ASIS moving superiorly and posteriorly, okay? So ASIS will be somewhere over here, so it moves superiorly and posteriorly, okay? So that is the second movement that you can used to describe the nutation. Or the third one is combination of both, that is the innominate bone going backward and the sacrum going forward. So to show you guys this actually in motion, I could not get bones, so I did some small jugaad. So I made this 3D model with which I can show you the movement. So basically the sacral promontory moving anteriorly would be this, so you can see the distance over here increasing. And the second would be the ASIS moving superiorly and posteriorly. So I'll keep this stable and ASIS moving this. So again, this distance will be increasing, right? So that is what happens in nutation. Now going to counter nutation, exactly opposite will be happening. So we'll see this quickly. So what will be happening over here? The sacral promontory will be going posteriorly. Okay, sacral promontory moves posteriorly and coccyx moves anteriorly, right? Exactly the opposite thing will be happening. Whereas what will be happening to your ASIS? ASIS will be going anteriorly and inferiorly, and the combination of both would be again the counter nutation. Now another small thing I wanted to mention over here is the relative motion. Now we have to keep in mind that when we are saying that there is nutation happening, when there is the innominate, this is the blue one, is the innominate bone, right? When it is going posteriorly like this, we are saying nutation is happening. but it's not exactly the nutation that is happening. It is a relative motion which is giving rise to nutation, meaning your sacrum is stable over here and the pelvis, no, sorry, not pelvis, the innominate bone, it goes backward, and that is what creates a nutation over here. And same thing over here, the ASI is going anteriorly, causing counter nutation. So these two, they are called as the relative motions. Okay, so that's all we have for your symmetrical movements. Going on to the asymmetrical movements, the pelvic torsion of innominate bones occur during ambulation. Okay, this is very important. This most of the times happens during ambulation. So what will happen is, when you're walking, let's get Joe into the picture over here. When you're walking, your hip will go for flexion, right? And the other leg will be in extension. So one leg flexion at the hip and other leg extension will be happening. So what this does is, there is different movements of the innominate bones, because your pelvis is like this, right? With the sacrum in middle. And when you're doing flexion on one side and extension on the other side, there is torsion that is occurring at the pelvis. Okay. So if I would like to show it, your sacrum will be moving in one direction. Then your innominate bone will be going in one direction, whereas the other side will be going in other direction. Okay. So this is a little hard to imagine, but basically what is happening is torsion is happening in the pelvis, and that is causing an asymmetrical movement. Here the movement was symmetrical, right? Both the sides of the innominate bone were moving equally and in the same direction, whereas over here what is happening is the movement is asymmetrical, and this creates the torsion in the SI joint region. Okay, so that is your asymmetrical movement. Another small thing I would like to mention over here is, it is a closed kinematic chain over here. You see, what is open and closed kinematic chain? In open, the distal part of the chain will be free to move. But over here, both the ends are connected together and it is creating a closed chain. So when there is some asymmetrical movement that will be happening, the movement will be happening at the SI joint as well as the pubic symphysis, the second articulation that is happening over here, right? Which is very important, that because it's closed chain, if there is some asymmetrical movement, the movement will be happening at SI as well as the pubic symphysis, both regions. Okay. Whereas if it's a symmetrical movement, like the nutation and counter nutation, what will happen? The movement does not have to happen at the symphysis pubis, right? Only sacral movement can happen, and this can remain stable. Whereas in asymmetrical movement, the movement will always occur at both SI joint as well as the pubic symphysis. Now, another point I wanted to mention is, nutation also occurs during the delivery of the baby, when the sacrum goes posteriorly again like this, and there is also increase in the pelvic outlet diameter, right? The diameter of the pelvic outlet increases so that the baby can pass out. This I will be mentioning in the next video with the kinetics. Okay, so stay tuned for that. So with that, we finish off this topic. So what did we see? We saw symmetrical and asymmetrical kinematics at the SI joint. So under symmetrical, we had our innominate bone with the sacrum. And what was happening over here? During nutation, the space over here was increasing, correct? And during counter nutation, the space was decreasing. And it can be described in three ways: with the movement of the sacrum, with the relative movement of your innominate bone, or movement of the both sacrum as well as the innominate bone. Okay, then we saw the asymmetrical movements, where the pelvic torsion happens during activities like ambulation, that is gait or walking, and this will also create movement at the pubic symphysis because it's in a closed kinematic chain, right? So with that, we finish off this topic. That's all for today, guys. Thank you for watching. If you like my video, please share it with your friends. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button and also like the video, as it really helps me out. Also, let me know in the comment section what other videos you would like me to cover. And see you soon in the next video.